In this passage from Luke's gospel, there are a number of ancient customs and rules of etiquette that may be unclear to all of us today. But the one thing I want you to pay attention for in this Bible reading is how Jesus manages to offend and insult everyone that he sees at this dinner party. So it starts in Luke chapter 14. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of a leader of the Pharisees for a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. Just then, in front of him, there was a man who had dropsy. And Jesus asked the lawyers and Pharisees, "Is it lawful to cure people on the Sabbath or not?" But they were silent. So Jesus took him and healed him and sent him away. Then he said to them, "If one of you has a child or an ox that has fallen into a well, will you not pull it out immediately on a Sabbath day?" And they could not reply to this. When Jesus noticed how the guests were choosing the places of honor, he told them a parable. "When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, 'Give this person your place.' And then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, 'Friend, move up higher.' And you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." He said also to the one who had invited him, "When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. In one of my favorite books about the life of Jesus, the author makes this claim. He says, "Jesus got himself killed because of how he ate." That's a pretty big claim. Jesus got himself killed because of how he ate. In the book called Eating Your Way Through Luke's Gospel, the author figured out that Jesus is always on his way to a meal, at a meal, or leaving a meal, and by the end of the gospel, he gets hung on a cross. Well, almost the end. We know that he actually gets raised from the dead in the end. But the author thinks that maybe how Jesus ate had something to do with why he got killed. And it makes sense, because Jesus broke a lot of rules. He didn't follow all of the Old Testament laws about eating or about the things you could do or not do on the Sabbath. Jesus also accepted dinner invitations from the wrong kinds of people. He would eat with people that were considered unclean and unworthy to share a meal with. And also, when Jesus was at dinner with people, he would say things to them that got under their skin. He would say things that were offensive, that were insulting. And he wasn't doing this to be a jerk. He was doing this because he wanted people to see the world in a different way. He wanted people to see how God invites us to live in this world. Jesus wanted people to get a glimpse of the kingdom of God. And sometimes they had to get a little offended to see that. He wanted them to see a way of living that invited everyone to the table, to a place where there's enough for all, where you don't have to push other people down in order to be raised up yourself. So in this Bible passage that I shared with you, Jesus managed to offend everybody he interacted with. He offended the people he was walking with to the dinner party by breaking a Sabbath rule and doing work, because healing people was considered doing work. And so he took a guy and healed him. It was the shortest healing story in the New Testament. It just says he took him, healed him, and sent him away. And so already then Jesus shows up at this dinner party and the people with him are like, ugh, he's breaking rules already. And then he looks at how all the guests are trying to find the best places to sit at this dinner party. Like, okay, what's the most important spot? And how can I sit at the right place and rub elbows with the right people? And they're all jockeying for the best spots. And then Jesus says, you know what would really be terrible? If everybody was always trying to sit at the best spot at a dinner party. And what if you're not all that? And there's somebody who shows up who's more all that than you? And wouldn't you feel dumb if you have to give up your sweet spot to go sit in the nosebleed section of the dinner party because you've thought you were much bigger and better than you really are? But Jesus tells this to a group of people who's already chosen and been fighting for all the best spots. So then he's offended all of them because they're all sitting there going, okay, well, we all have already been doing that. But Jesus wasn't done. He also then says to the host, the person who invited him, you know what's really terrible is when people invite just the powerful and influential and well-connected people to their dinner parties. Isn't that terrible? As he's looking at it, all the powerful and influential and well-connected people at the dinner party, he's like, the host may think he's being generous, but really he's not, because he knows these people are going to invite him to their dinner parties, and they all break even in the end. If you really want to be generous, invite the people who never get invited to a dinner party. Invite the people who have been rejected from society, the people who are often left out, the people who aren't easy to get along with. Try inviting those people to your dinner party. So he manages to make the host be offended, the guests be offended, the people he was walking with be offended, all so that they could see things in a new way. And I wanted to follow the example of Jesus, so I thought, how could I offend everybody today in church and make them feel super uncomfortable? Then I came up with the perfect plan. Let's have a family meeting about money. Huh? Did anybody survive the other time I did a family meeting? If you were here in the fall, you survived my other family. Okay, don't run for the door. This is not a common occurrence, but since we have a table and a table is a good place to have a family meeting, I thought I would sit here at the table. Oh, this bench just keeps being shorter than I think it's going to be, and I almost fell off of it on Wednesday night too. Anyway, don't run for the door. This is not a common occurrence, but it is an important occurrence. Because Jesus, his second favorite topic was money and possessions. If you count up all the things that Jesus said in the Gospels, his first favorite topic to talk about was the kingdom of God, that vision of how God wants us to live and be and care for one another. And if you were to count up the second most popular topic that Jesus addressed, it was money and possessions. Because Jesus knows how much of a hold money and possessions have on us. Not that money and possessions are evil, but yet money and possessions impact us in big ways and are connected to every area of our life. And we spend money on the things we value. And Jesus knows that. So I thought this would be a good opportunity to have a quick family meeting about money and ministry at Good Shepherd. And don't run for the door. And I hope to make you as uncomfortable as I can, but it won't be long. So when we did this last time, it was in the last few months of last year, and we had a family meeting during a sermon to talk about how we were behind in meeting our financial commitments and our ministry budget for 2019. And we wanted to make sure that by the end of 2019, we had met our ministry commitments and that we were going to be able to be good partners to our ministries out in the community and in the world. And after the family meeting that we had where I talked about how a budget is put together and how much things cost and what we've committed ourselves to, we had 55 more people sign up to be part of our automated giving program, which was such a beautiful thing. We also had a number of other folks who currently gave increase their giving at the end of the year so that at the end of 2019, we broke even. We were just a little bit better than breaking even. so that we were able to fulfill all of those ministry commitments for 2019. And I wanted to make sure that at the beginning of 2020, in this first quarter, that we're starting off strong, that we are able to do the ambitious things as a church family that we set out to do this year. And so I wanted to show us a few numbers and just walk through what our hopes are for this year. We, at our January annual meeting, we approved a budget that was 9% bigger than 2019. And that's because we are a growing congregation and our building is getting more use and we've added some more staff and we want to do bigger things together. And so by talking about money at the beginning of this year and inviting our whole church family to be a part of the giving at this church, I thought, let's talk about this in March. So I've got one slide here that talks about how we have 869 households at Good Shepherd between our 8:30 in the morning service and this service and our 10 o'clock service at Sanctuary and people who come on Wednesday nights. These are all of our families put together. And now we have 265 who do regular automated giving at Good Shepherd on a consistent basis, and that's 55 more than last year. That's wonderful. Not included in these numbers is the people who give checks and cash, which adds up to almost half, or actually a little over half of our families who are members of Good Shepherd. Now, this is a big thing for us because last year in 2019, we had under half of our congregation supporting our mission that we do together. And now we have a little over half, so we've tipped that scale. So that's amazing. But there's still room to grow. And I don't say this to guilt anybody, but to just give you the raw facts on how people are contributing to Good Shepherd. Then I have a next slide, which would be if we were to divide up our church budget that pays our mortgage and staff and ministry projects and resources we use all year, if every family gave $24 a week all year out of our 869 families, that would meet the budget. But that isn't a very good way to look at it, in my opinion, because people come from a lot of different places. And for some, that's a heavy lift, and for others, they go well beyond that. And so that's just the black and white way to look at it. Then I've got another number we could look at, that 135 of our 869 families contributed 69% of our total giving budget. And that's pretty amazing. We've got some people who really go above and beyond. Some of them are people of means. Some of them are just really crazily generous. And it really matters. I was talking to somebody who has been a longtime faithful giver at Good Shepherd, and he told me that he understands trust more than he understands faith. And trust is very connected to why he gives. He says that when he started reading the Bible on his own, in his own personal devotion time, he kept seeing the word trust showing up over and over again, and how the people in the Bible could learn to trust God because God kept showing up for them. And he decided to trust God with his finances too, to become a regular giver. And he said that he believes he can safely give because God has never failed him and God has never failed anybody else either. So his giving comes from a place of trust. And I thought that was a beautiful testimony from him. But here's the final slide I want to show you. One simple way that we could have our budget be met, that we could do some really significant ministry projects in 2020, is if we had 200 more families giving $10 per week. That's my big ask. This is my big way that I'm hoping to make you uncomfortable, the way Jesus made people feel uncomfortable. If you are not contributing or have not been contributing consistently or regularly, I'm going to invite you to consider being part of those 200 families. The church is a really amazing place that operates 100% on people voluntarily giving something to support the ministry they participate in. And I think it's important. I believe that what we do at this church is significant in this community. I believe that my own faith is strengthened by having a faith community that I can be accountable to and that I can grow with. I believe that my son's faith is strengthened by seeing other kids learning about Jesus and seeing other adults worshiping Jesus and being leaders here. I believe that this church does a beautiful job of showing up for each other when life is hard. Because sometimes you are in a tough spot where you need people to pray for you and walk with you and understand what you're going through and open the door for you. And sometimes you're feeling strong and you are that person who can be there for others. And you can be the person who prays for and supports others. I believe that our church should be a place that is not only a place of safety and comfort, but is a place of challenge, is a place where we put before you some hard things that otherwise we may not want to hear about. My hope is that we can show hard ministry realities or hard realities that people in this world have to face, homelessness, addiction, struggles that others face that we would maybe not want to address. But when we say all of these people are valued by God, how could we as a church family help those in our community and in our world who are struggling? We want to be known in this place for the level of care that we have for one another and how we can show up for each other and show up for our community. And I believe that we spend money on things that we value. And so I invite you to not only share of your time and your talents, but also share in the financial ministry of this church as well. Because each and every one of us have a valuable part to play. And it's not a pay-to-play system. God is going to give us grace no matter what. But yet we have an opportunity to be challenged, to be strengthened, to really grow in our faith here in this place. So that's my money talk for all of us today. That's my family meeting, my hope to make you feel uncomfortable, but also to say there is a place for you here no matter what. And we're thankful for the ways that you show up. Amen. Let's pray. Dear God, I thank you for everyone here at Good Shepherd. I thank you for how you show up for us, how you show up in this place with us, how you encourage us, how you challenge us, how you cause us to evaluate and reevaluate how we're living and where our priorities are. We pray that you would give us forgiveness when we mess up, forgiveness when we don't live up to your vision, when we don't care for one another as you've called us to. And we pray that we could continually have that fresh start where we can show up for one another in a new day, where we can do big things together, where we can be known for the kind of love that we share in this place. In Jesus' name, amen.